Okay, for this course, it's a special arrangement. We follow the same teaching style school in UK. So in UK, what they did for the Central 4N is actually try to do. Okay, so basically, two faculty in charge. Maybe let me show you the. UK is also called Central 4, but we call Central 4 the 4S. Basically, it's N represents the body, means the middle. And 2S is the middle, and basically, the two bodies are exactly the same as the Central 4 in Glasgow, UK. So in Glasgow, UK, they have a two person in charge. One is Professor Eric, the other is Dr. Matthews. So in UK, Eric is taking care of the analog part, and Matthew is taking care of the analog. Okay, so in the same, in Singapore, have you all taken over, right?
No.
You know, right? You know, right? Okay, so if you are taking care of the analog part, okay, and transition over, and we are help. So it's under the same module flow, but basically divided into two parts. One is for the analog control. So I think Rich, we are going to teach you how to do the design for analog control system. So basically you are going to learn further based on what you have learned in your dynamics control. You have learned your dynamics control, right? Yes, no. Yes, right? So if you have learned the dynamics and control, basically you have some good understanding about modeling, right? In a continuous domain, right? So you are able to do that like before, right? Yes or no? Should be yes, right? Anyway, if you have problems in that before, you know I'm not trouble in my part, but I believe the thing will have a few problems in this part. Okay, so basically, you have learned your dynamics and control, so you are able to do modeling. So what does modeling do? Modeling means to study the right of a head, the stem, the process, the machine, the device, the best scenario, right? So after you have learned the dynamic system, you are able to bring up and present a physical system in some mechanical, right? What are mechanical? After you have learned the dynamic. No. So what do you come in with this control? Q老五加抛物啊。 How do you think about that? Alright? Okay, so basically, after you have learned your dynamics, you should be able to do the modeling of any system. Then the modeling usually may be described as differential equation. Why differential equation? Because dynamics is talking about the equation of time. So when the time change, you will have different value. And differential means the rate of change. So differential equation basically is used mathematical to describe what the physical relationship or what are the physical properties or characteristics in a function time. So after you get the differential equation, what you are able to do? If you are really good in maths, you should be able to refer to your ODE, right? Do you know how to solve differential equation? Yes. If you know how to solve the differential equation theoretically for any physics system, you know the differential equation, you should be able to solve the differential equation, so you should be able to know their characteristic equations. So you can describe all the physical properties, no matter if you're talking about speed, velocity, you're talking about acceleration, you're talking about power loss, you're talking about the torque, you're talking about the voltage, energy, and so on, whatever item, whatever physical property you are interested in, you should be able to do a function. Now once you come a function, you finish your modeling side. Right? So this is the modeling part. Then the other part is called control. So what do we mean for control? Control means we want the system to be a certain value, to be a certain factor. For example, I want to control the speed of the car. I want the speed of the car to be 80 km per hour, right? Then in the end, the car should be far by 80 km per hour. If it's not too slow, too fast, it's not based on my purpose. So basically, control is you want your output to be something what you want, to be something what you expect. So this is the control. Then basically, you have certain mathematical to describe. You use open loop, closed loop, whatever, right? Then you design some control like PID controller or some other controllers, right? To make sure your control variable is something you want to learn. So this should be something you have learned. You have learned, right? But maybe you have forgotten some part. Okay, so later, for the first week, and go through a quick review, okay, in the basic modeling and the end of the part. Okay? But for this module, we come, in which we have teach you more techniques, more tools to do the analysis. So I believe we have done the classic control based on the Laplace transform here, right? Have you done the control function? Yes, right. How about this one? Or if you do something wrong, you can go home. Can you hear me now? Yes or no?
Yes.
So have you learned the Laplace transform?
Yes.
Have you learned the transform function?
Yes.
Okay, that's the correct class. Otherwise, it's probably really a very good class. Okay. So later for interest one, she will give you another briefing theory for English medicine, right? For the actual medicine. So for this one, as I mentioned, we are going to divide into parts. I'm going to handle the mounting modeling lecture, which I'm going to teach you about digital control. Again, I'm interested in covering the analog control. I think the class is Wednesday. And in my part, we are only going to touch the digital part. And half of my part actually is pretty simple. It's just to teach you how to convert from analog to digital. Then from digital, come back to analog. Okay? And as the last part, we're going to discuss something how to apply and write. So basically for digital control, there are two means. One means your control itself, your system itself is still an analog system. You can still apply whatever technology you have learned in your analog control. But later you are going to convert to digital. Okay? And later I will review why you need to do so. Okay? And secondly, another way is so called direct digital control. So that's why we will do the modeling, we will do the control, we will do everything from digital. So we have a digital input, we have digital controller and digital output. So for the learning resources, after you have been enrolled to the Moodle system, I think Idris will enable the material according to the teaching case. For me, you go to the button. You should be able to see the digital control. I have put all the lecture material from Glasgow in UK. So basically, in UK, they're using the handwritten notes. Luckily, the lecture there, handwriting is actually quite good. So, pretty well readable. So, if you don't want to purchase the textbook, so at least you go to print out the copy of this.
Shit.
I have suggested to you to ask it to come up something to the high version of those slides. Today, you still easy, no time, no sticker paper. So, anyway, the head written note is still readable. Okay, and actually, it's also good, right? So, you can through the handwriting to understand the logic of the thinking flow. Another good news for this year is, okay, first of all the exam, they'll be handled by Glasgow side, so they will make the exam question, the exam question, and so forth. And for this module, it's 100% based on the exam, right? Okay. And the good thing is, we have decided to invite him to come to Singapore close to the exam period, one semester. Okay, so he will going to have a special session for Singapore students. So anything related to exam, you know, just ask the question. But the good thing is, he said that you can send the exam before we receive the exam. For me, I will send my exam. I think he's a very kind person, so he is a very, very busy person. So, last time I thought that the SP side nobody failed for the private exam. But this one, I don't know. Anyway, it's coming in November, so later you just... So don't ask me for anything about them, I don't know the thing. I'm not the one to tell people, but I'm the one to help you to learn more about them. I do hope, after my... about 3 months with you, right? After the Christmas, then if someone ask you, hey, have you learned something about this? Have you learned something about that? Ask you something also to know. I don't want another lecture man, he or she asking some question related to my module. I hope you all be smart. I'm studying different from what I received just now. Okay. Okay, I also understand some of students may prefer to have some PowerPoint or some versions. So I also put the Singapore version. Based on the information I captured from the textbook, as well as from the lecture from the Glasgow side, to put as a PowerPoint slides. Okay? So before class, I will release one version. So basically that version will be, because they are trying to do some exercise during the class. Okay, so for those answers will be removed, okay, on the student's version. But after the class finish, I will upload the full version. Which means all my input. Is it correct? Okay, so for the student, if you are keen to learn the solutions, don't get to pick photo. Okay, but remember after class, maybe Tuesday or Wednesday, you go to visit the Moodle again, the same section, you will see the update for the PDF. Is it correct? So this is my office home. deduction do and plus at SD. Okay? So if you got some questions, you can send me an email first. Okay, then after the class, we can try to schedule some time. Okay? So basically all the learning resources that we put up this room. And because the class full size is on top of this book, my understanding is this textbook will only purchase in the US. And they give a discount to a student. I think plus the shipping or something is about $60 something like that. Okay? So if you are interested to learn more, I recommend you, I encourage you to come to me. But I also understand most likely your senior may have purchased the book. Okay, so not because of this stuff. I would suggest maybe the best thing you want to do is contact the senior. Have the trade that we work with just my second hand. First of all, I believe the price will be discounted, right? And also, you know it will be free for the shipping from the US. Okay, unfortunately, they do have a local publisher here. And also, in the discussion, ask the class to try to check. Okay, but this is their program, not my program. Okay, if I'm working, I will ask for at least something okay. But this is a very minor module, so we can follow their practice. Okay. So basically, the Glasgow side we have five, last year we came to, this year we came to six, but anyway, it's the same. Okay, the same material, you just need to design either 5 parts or 6 parts. Okay. The head goes for the lecture, okay, for the teacher to go back. From my part, I will put my Singapore version slides, okay, on the Moodle square. So basically, what I'm going to cover is the digital control. So, what do we mean for the digital control? What's the relationship between digital control and control? So, in your Dynamics are modeling, I believe you should be familiar with this system. So this is the typical closed loop feedback control. So you have some inputs from the environment, for example, right? For example, I want to control the speed of my car. So first of all, I need to have some sensor, right? I need to have some speed sensor to measure the speed, to measure the acceleration, right? So I know how much is my car speed. If I want my speed to be 80 km/h, but my current speed is only about 50 km/h. So we have my input also has some comparison, right? Between the input from the sensor as my desired speed, or sometimes we call the set point, right? So if they match, there is no error, right? If they mismatch, there will be error. So the error can go to the system, and then the system is where you will design your controller and the digital, right? Then this one we have a couple of some output. I believe in your dynamics we call manipulator variable, right? We call manipulator variable ME. Okay? So your manipulator variable we have something like the engine, right? In your driving car, so we will be called up here. Then the call up the engine, we have a fat overall process. Right? Affect the dynamic system of the car. Because you have the force from the engine, so you have an acceleration. Then the acceleration, right? You have the force from the engine, you also counter the acceleration from the wheel. Also maybe some of the air friction, right? When you are really moving very fast according to the air that moves. Then eventually you want to affect your process system, then you can drive at another speed. Then this speed will be measured again. As your other input. So for the continuous control, basically they are assured. Everything, every time, any time you can have the input, output, and you can use it. But actually, it's not true. In most of the cases. In most of the cases nowadays, you only take in the input at certain settings. Not at any instantaneous moment. Maybe once a second, maybe 100 times a second, or maybe 1,000 times a second, or 1 million times a second. No matter how fast it is, it's not infinity. Okay, so usually, you have some discrete setting period for you to think. Also for your controller. Nowadays, no matter how fast the CPU is, you still have a limited speed, right? So currently our CPU is very fast, maybe you can go about 2 gigahertz or even 10 gigahertz, but still certain gigahertz, right? Not infinity. So basically, actually what we are thinking, the input, what we are dealing with the controller, or what we are responding or set up the output, actually they are in a digital domain. They are in a discrete domain. So in digital domain, it just adds this part into a traditional analog system. So instead of continuous time, okay, remember if it's a continuous, usually we use a small letter. If you see a small letter T, it is means analog. If you see a capital T, processing is a digital. Okay? So the capital T in digital systems or digital control represents a period, the sampling period. So if your processing sampling frequency is 1 hertz, your period is 1 second. If it's 1 gigahertz, your period is 1 power -9. Okay? I have to see a K. This K is the number of samples. The first sample, second sample, third sample, fourth sample. So it's a digital method. Okay? So in the digital system, our input should be digital. Then our processor, our controller, our compositor, our filter, also digital ones. And after you calculate your output, but remember, the effect to the real physical step is still analog. Okay? My voice, my body movement are analog. Right? But if you use a camera to capture frame by frame, right? Actually, your video is just a very fast camera. So you digitize. Then after you digitize it, you get all the different parts. Of course, after the timing it is, you will see the closer to the perfect analog. So this thing is a relationship between the digital and the analog. So for this one, you have three parts. One is if you have an analog input, but the sensor, for example, the speed, the temperature, the pressure, the force, whatever, is supposed to be an analog physical data, right? Your car is moving, the speed of the car is a continuous function. You don't have any single moment, there is no speed, right? So it's supposed to be a continuous physical value. But when we're going to pick a sensor, really measure, a digital sensor to measure, use a sensor to measure data, I use a digital transmitter to transmit to my CPU. Then what is the data I really have? I have a digital speed. I have a digital data. So here we will have analog to digital conversion. Okay, from my analog input converter to my digital. So the second part is in name, be a digital controller or maybe your analog controller function. In the computer, you can do the control, the process of control in the digital mode. So after you calculate, you will have a digital input to your process. So you have a digital input to control your engine. Type 1 to save a voltage signal or current signal to control your engine to control the power. But eventually, your power will affect your speed, will affect your process. So here you have a digital to analog converter. So in my module, in my part, we are only teaching 3 things. Analog to digital, digital to analog, and digital control. For the rest, is based, you are going to use a motor control. M1 is a control technique you are going to learn, but so what? Why do we need to learn about digital control? Why? Because digital is much better than many years ago, when you listen to some of the music or you watch on TV, it is on campus. Right? And that analog signal is, first of all, you may have noise. Okay? First of all, you may be, you might be easily affected by noise. Because it is just an analog, for example, multi signal, okay, to represent something. Then you to grounding or you to some other people making a call or so forth, right? You may also generate certain voltage for magnetic signals. If your signal transmission is in analog way, then will be very easily affected by the noise. But if you are using digital, you are going to be encoded, right? You are using different certain protocol or certain standard to represent a digital signal. So the tolerance to the noise. So that's the reason now in Singapore you almost cannot find any analog TV. Most of the TV now are digital. Previously, if you have, you still have the analog TV receiver, you compare with those digital TV receiver, you will see the difference, right? The picture, the resolution, the picture stability, and so forth. So digital much better, okay, quality than the analog. Analog usually is in only one channel, one signal. If you have two signals in the same channel, so you will have some effect, right? For example, I said 4 to 20 milliamps in the digital process, or in the digital analog industry process. I have 4 to 20. 4 to 20 milliamps means if I have 4 milliamps, it's 0. 20 milliamps is maximum. So you have one channel, it's not over. But if I have two signals in one channel, I receive a 6 milliamp, I don't know whether, sorry, if I receive 16 milliamp, I don't know whether it's 4 plus 12, or whether it's 10 plus 6, or any other time. But if I'm using digital, I'm able to enable multiple signals at the same channel. So this is the reason now you see your at home, no matter your binder, your TV, whatever, it's a very thin line, and it can carry a lot of channels, okay, into the system. So there are many reasons, okay, for digital to be better, much better than analog. I believe you should have learned something from another module. You have learned something about signal, right? You have one module about signals. Okay, so this is just something. So how can we convert analog signal to digital signal? So basically we are going to do sampling. Sampling means we are going to base on the clock. Okay, base on the digital clock. Digital clock, we are going to determine the frequency. We are going to determine the period. We are going to determine the sampling frequency. So based on the clock, every cycle, I'm going to read the reading. So this is an analog signal. So after I put sensor, I get something like this. So this is analog, convert to analog. Okay. But basically, there are two things you want. One is horizontally. Horizontally, you have limiter. So means you have certain time period. In between the sampling time period, those information in the analog side. Okay. So this is something we don't know how we are going to address this one. And another thing you also need to bear in mind is vertically. In the analog system, theoretically, you can represent the value precisely into infinite resolution. But in a real digital world, No matter how good your computer is, sometimes even you may want to choose some cheaper processor or so in your system or something. Anyway, no matter how good the processor is, you have a limited memory. So once you have limited memory, you will only design a certain number of bytes to represent any number. So let me say if you are using 1 bit, then you are only represent 0 and 1. If you are using 4 bit, you have 2 power 4, which is 16. If you are using 1 byte, it's 8 bit, it's 2 by 6. So any value in the range, you can only divide by 2 by 6. Of course, nowadays you may want to choose 1 gigabyte or 1 gigabyte of error. I'm happy to use a 1 gigabyte to get 1 gigabyte. So you see, you use 1 byte, 2 byte, or 16 byte, whatever, to represent a number. Then you just use your mathematics and logic. You have limited resolution for any data you want to solve. As you have limited resolution, that means vertically. You have certain runoff. For example, last year or year. You see the exact. So you have a centering time to become centered. Centering with contact, you have limited duration. Then happy, right? I think it's about 5 hours. Okay, let's do a simple exercise to see the effect of the And if you apply certain building walls, for example, mechanic system, less green target system, right? You apply water store, you apply water store, you do the physical study, you actually should come up with a certain way. If electric circuit, right? You have voltage, you have current, you have capacitor, you have inductor, you have resistor, right? So you apply waveform, voltage, and power law, you apply those relationships between resistance, voltage, and so forth, right? Eventually, also come out of electric, that means the program. So eventually, what you get differential equation, right? So based on this differential equation, you have two board, that touch the form. If you do the left hand transform, you get the two function, you start to form the control. Later with this module, you are going to learn how to use, which I will find your space-based function. Okay? And if you understand this, you will learn because this space is some of the best, right? Correct? Okay, so you also can cover the physical differential equation, okay, to space space. Then you can apply certain techniques, okay, in the space-based domain to design and make sure the system is okay, based on these two, you can represent or you can modeling your system in flawed effort. Right? And you can also, based on the flawed effort, you can put some or either you can function or your state space, you can put certain analysis of the pole and material, right? Because based on the pole and material location, you understand or roughly you can determine the characteristic of your system. Right? This is something you should have learned. So in your dynamics control, the key point, okay, is differentiation equations. So for example, this is the differential equation, it's a very typical second order differential equation, right? So in order to handle this one, actually you got three ways. First way, if you are very good in math, okay, if you are genius in math, apply your ODE, PBE, whatever. Okay, solve the differential equation. After you solve the differential equation, you get the function y something equal to t, right? You get the y as a function of time, right? So if you're really good in math, okay, you can solve, you can cover that technique. But the challenging part is if it's first order, second order, right, I believe you have learned your math or something. So first order, second order differential equation you can solve by your hand, right? But once you go to third, fourth, then you may get a right time to solve this equation, but you may not really want to ignore the line, this kind of thing, right? So this is the reason in control we are going to introduce second and third way to solve this equation. So what is the second way? Second way is something you have learned. Do the Laplace transform. Okay, the good thing to do the Laplace transform is after you have done the Laplace transform, you can convert your differential equation to n. Differential equation is something you can only solve when you are in university, but maybe you only be able to solve up to the second order. But if you convert to h prime, it means no differentiation, no integration, just multiplication by different orders. Then it might be much easier to solve, right? Alright? Especially after you have learned your calculus, you have learned your linear algebra, you have learned your linear algebra, you are able to solve all the linear algebra. So this is a reason, one way is to convert the differential equation to S. Then in the control, we use the transfer function, which is the S form of output divided by the S form of input. We use this one to describe the relationship between the input and output in the S domain. Okay? So the magic or the strategy of the Laplace transform is a very complicated differential equation which is difficult to solve. Some edge problem, which is much. It's It's much easier for you to describe, much easier for you to solve, indeed, and also much easier for you to multiply, multiply, and so on. For the data, you do certain analysis. Okay. Of course, is there another way which you have to learn and explain more? They come from another lecture, is to cover this one to the state space. You can learn this one already. You learn this? Yes, okay, good. So another way is you can convert to the state space, right? So you use the state space, you convert the very complicated or even high order differential equation to only first order differential equation. Only first order differential equation, but represent by certain matrices. So you combine your matrices, which you have learned your extra, with first order differential equation. Okay. And this one is support the border control, this one is support the class. So the Laplace transform, okay, maybe we just do a quick review. Okay. Auto things is something that should you have learned about it. Understand maybe some of you may have forgotten. Okay, so we have you. You still remember it's good, okay, then it's the time for you to review. So the Laplace transform today is doing some integration, okay, with your time domain function, then cover to S, okay, as S is a complex variable. And the key result concerning the transfer function of the derivative of function is to convert the differentiation into the integration. Then come to our integration. So the Laplace transform, you can convert the equation to what? You can convert the equation, right, into a finite equation. If you have a first-time differentiation, you get finite by S. If you get second-time differentiation, you get S squared. Okay, if you have n times of differentiation, you get n power of, sorry, S of n. Right? Check out my equation. So if you do the Laplace transform equation, what do you get? You get equation. You get divided by S. If you first order differential, first order equation divided by S, second order equation you get divided by S squared. So that is something good. So no matter what the order of your differential function it is, you can eventually convert or transfer it to algebraic equation. So which one you think is easier for you to solve? Which one is easier for you to solve? Which one? Definitely the algebra one, right? This one should be true, lah, right? And once we have completed the transfer function, so after we have completed the Laplace transform, both my input and output left hand side and right hand side. Then I have a function in S domain. Then I'm able to evaluate what the relationship is the input and output. Then the input output, I just put all those polynomial functions, okay, up and down. Then we have a relationship. Then by using the Laplace transform, I create and obtain the transfer function. And now the transfer function is the key function. Because the transfer function is corresponding to the volume. It's corresponding to the dynamic system. So once you know the dynamic system, you have unique. Now once you have the transfer function, you know the characteristic of your dynamic system. So now you are able to use something very reasonable as the transfer function represents your basic curve. But of course, they are also empirical. For you to describe or for you to solve a transfer function, you may not want to solve in this form. This form may be very complicated. So sometimes you may want to do some factorization to make a high order polynomial function to be a multiplication of first order functions. Then you, after you have done certain factorization, eventually you will be able to represent the system with only first order. Once a week of first order, you must be here for you to
when
offer
do
bags from your large and small to your kind of people. If you still, because in the end, we are still interested about the dynamic form. We have only used this one to swap the equation, but after swapping, we still want to see what is my input according to time. At time equal to 0, how much is time? At time equal to 0, how much is time? I
can't even buy.
So eventually, I still want to get the time to function. But after you get the control function, if you want to do the inverse Laplace transform, you swap the derivative. But how do you do the inverse Laplace transform? You reverse the so-called table, right? So usually the table gives you what? When the table gives you some transform function, do the inverse Laplace transform to third order, fourth order, or 100 order, no way. You refer to the table, you need to give you the typical high domain transform in first order, second order. So in order to make sure you are able to do the inverse Laplace transform easily, the good thing to dealing with polynomial function is we can handle by factorization. We can use some factorization to bring down this high order to be a combination of the first and second order only. And the good thing is, Laplace transform means your system is linear. If it's linear, after you bring down, you do the Laplace inverse Laplace transform again, you will still get it back. Okay, but as a university student, right, please do have a caution. Laplace transform only apply for linear system. If your system is linear, you can do Laplace transform in a linear function. If it's not linear, okay, if it's not linear, you cannot. And the linearity is important is because it is a linear system, so you can do the inverse Laplace transform one by one, then you combine together. You will still get back your initial function equivalent. But if your system is non-linear, if you apply the Laplace transform or you apply the factorization, you will get something equivalent. What they mean is, if your system is linear, the linearity means you have a high number position. So if you have function x plus y, it should be the same as you get the function of x plus the function of y. This one will only apply if your system is linear. If your system is not linear, it's not going to apply. So why this one is important? Because when we do the Laplace transform, so for example, I have a system. Let's do a very simple thing. Okay, so this is simple S domain function, right? So if we do the inverse Laplace transform, so actually what we did, usually we want to do a simple way. So this is something we want to do, right? Alright. But in order to make this one to be equal, what is the condition? The Laplace transform is a linear operator. Because this is linear, so actually what you are doing now is this is considered your fx, this is considered your fy. You are doing something about your x plus y. This is your x and y. Right? It's the same as you do the fx and fy. So this is can be considered as the x. This can be considered as y. Right? So your Laplace transform is a function. Because the Laplace transform is a linear, okay, it's a linear operation. So you can do this factorization. After you have done the factorization, you get simple form. Then based on the simple function, you do the inverse Laplace transform, you get back to your time domain characteristic. And if you are familiar with MATLAB, actually you can also use MATLAB or some of the function code. So first of all, I come up a system, okay, a transfer function. So this is a transfer function. Then in MATLAB, there are some function code, CGP. Also, okay, you also have something. But if you know the zero whole again, right, you can also use another way. And you also have some LF code. You can easily convert your Laplace or your transform function to the KP. Okay, this one is something I think you may enjoy more after you learn more details in this case. Because this case basically are four matrices. Okay, to be present. And you are able to convert from the CDK to FGM. And in your dynamics and control, you also have learned a basic or typical input to a system to test the output. So you have applied a step function. You also got RAM. You also got second order or sine or cosine. And actually, you also have one very important thing, which one I did not mention, but you have learned. Very important. Have you learned any other input which is not mentioned here? Very impulse. Yes, which is impulse function is one of the most important input in control. So later we are going to cover in review in detail about the impulse. Okay. And another interesting window for the function is the final value theorem. Because in most of the modeling system, we are interested in the final value. If your system is unstable, first of all, if your system is unstable, how much is your final value? If your system is unstable, how much is what do we mean unstable? What do we mean unstable? If the system is unstable, what do we mean? You can never convert, right? Correct. If a system is stable, means eventually your system can be converted to a certain value. Right? A stable state here. If your system is unstable, means your value can either increase to the maximum infinity or decrease to the negative infinity, right? Alright. So if your system is unstable, your final value should be infinity. No matter whether it's positive or negative infinity, it's something infinity. And in practical, if you spoil either you spoil your system or reach the saturation of your system. Okay? You also have marginally stable, right? Still remember marginally stable? What does marginally stable mean? And the sine or cosine form keep oscillating, right? Keep oscillating at a certain range. So for that one, you also don't have any identical value for your final state. Because you never convert. So first of all, when you apply the final value theorem, the first condition must be your system must be stable. Your system is unstable, your system is marginally stable. You don't have final value, or your final value is infinity. Okay, there is no means for us to talk about. We only interest if your system is stable, so we want to know where you are. After you stabilize, where you are, how much value it is, how much is final value. Okay, so for the final value, of course, if you know the time domain function, what you are going to do? You are going to find the limit when your t approach to infinity. Alright? That one, first of all, this one the condition, you know the time function. And secondly, you have applied the limit time to infinity. Usually it's more tedious. But the good thing is, after you get the transfer function, what is the final value? The final value will be the transfer function or us find the limit of length of S approach to So for this one, may be much easier for you to find out the final value. Because in most of the time, when you are giving a physics system, most of the time the physics system may be very complicated. It is either very tedious or almost impossible for you to get the time to If we are not able to get the time to wave function, but we are still interested to know how much is the final value, then the system So what we are going to do? We have get the transfer function, we have get the function in the S domain. Without solving it, this one you don't need to solve. You don't need to convert, you don't need to use the inverse Laplace transform to convert. You don't need to do any inverse conversion. You just multiply your S function with the S. Multiply this. Then take the limit. But here then take it's not limit S to infinity, right? It's a limit when you add So after you have good understanding in the differential equation and how to convert the differential equation through Laplace transform or state space transform to get some either algebra function or first order differential equation, then you're able to use it in practice. Then you can apply different type of design in control. Compositor or filter to control your system. And mathematically, this is a typical closed loop feedback system. And in control, which usually we use the G to represent the M, we use the S to represent the feedback. Okay, we use these are sigma plus or minus to take the difference between your set point and your actual environment output. So if you have the plan and you have the feedback, then your transfer function for closed loop, this one is your closed loop, right? Then if you have a closed loop, your transfer function will be your GS divided by 1 plus HS times GS. So the HS is the feedback. So there are many ways for you to represent a limit system. You can represent as a transfer function, you can represent as a plot vector. And now you should be able to play with each other, right? So if I give you a transfer function, I use it to draw a plot vector. Yes, right? I think this is something you have learned in the MC paper, right? And like, if I give you a plot vector, are you able to convert? Or can you divide the transfer function to the plot vector? Yes, right? And this may be something you have enjoyed your MATLAB simulation, right? You have some block, right? Actually, your MATLAB simulation basically are block errors, right? So each block you have some function, right? Then you use the error plus the minus, right? Okay, now, the exact for you. So now I have a tree block diagram. I have a tree differential equation. Can you help me to link which one is which one? Okay, I give you 5 minutes, you are encouraged to discuss with your neighbors. Okay, about 10. Then how about the rest? 7 minutes. Okay, Okay, give you another one more minute. How many of you get A in your language as a job? Nobody. Good luck. Okay, how many of you pass the language as a job? Also none. Okay, now again, for the first one, how many think is this one? This? Now, not good, not good more. This one?
Yeah, good.
This one?
Four.
Okay. This one means X plus PY. Then divide by S is what? Divide S is what? Okay, basically if we go through this way, we are going to see it's Xp plus Eye. Divide by S means integration, right? Y plus Y So by using the impulse response, you are able to represent your transform function, which is the characteristic description of your system by output. So the output of the input transform function actually is the same as your transform function. But now you are able to use some instrument, some measurement to record down the response. So the good thing is, if you have a system which is a black box, actually I don't know what it achieves. Okay? I have a black box. I cannot open, I have no means, or it's very difficult for me to obtain any physical modeling. I don't know what is the physical equation at all. I only have a black box. What I can do? I can put an impulse input function. So I give an impulse input. And measure the output. Even though I don't know the physical modeling at all, okay? It means actually you don't get to learn the dynamics and the you don't get to learn the dynamics part, okay, of the previous modeling. You only have a black box, okay? I don't need to do any physical analysis. I have no clues what is the mathematic equation is. I don't know. I have a black box. But my black box I can put input. If I give an impulse input, I measure the output I get. I get the response of my system. And through that response, I'm able to bring out the output function. Maybe measure, maybe talk. To do certain analysis, to write how much or what is the black box function. Okay. So the impulse input is very important. This one can determine the characteristic of your transform function through your output. Because the output of the input of the impulse response should be your. That's because the Laplace transform of this one is 1. So if we give a first order of the impulse, then we are able to measure the output. If I remeasure the output like this, then this one actually is despite the characteristic of my output. So for example, initially I don't know what the system it is. I measure from the output, I get this probe. Through this probe, there are certain ways we may be able to divide that or estimate what should be the number. So if we know this is the first order, but actually I don't know how much is the C part. But I input the impulse input. I measure the output. Then I can look for the time constant. Once I determine the time constant, I can determine the first order input. Similarly, if you have a second order, for example, I know my system is supposed to be a second order system. For example, you have your spring mass energy system, it's supposed to be a second order, right? But, for example, you don't know what is the constant for the spring. Or for example, you don't know what is the friction, okay, for the friction. So, you don't have a way to describe the system through physical dimension, right? In case you don't know what is the okay, of all the conditions. But what you can do, you can give an impulse input. From the impulse input, you can measure the output displacement, right? Then based on the output displacement is a 2 second order timing system. Then you're able to measure the, you are able to determine the frequency, you are able to determine certain values, right? Then you are able to approximate your second order existing system, right? This is something I think you have learned in your dynamics and yes. Yes or no? Yes? To be yes, right? I saw some exact question on that. No. There was something else. So for example, if I get the impulse response, okay, then I'm eventually able to represent the system given to the time. There are also some MATLAB time to okay for you to practice what you need. So as an engineer, you can use whatever tool you want. A MATLAB or some other foundation or method you want. Then after you graduate, 1 year later, you get an engineer. You want to design something, you are supposed to be able to do it. Okay? But also another issue for the exam. Unfortunately, so far there is no computer around being your exam. So you are not able to use MATLAB or whatever to solve those design problems for you. All positions.